Good evening, and it's again my privilege to welcome you to this opening of the Word of God together, this time of study in the Word of God. And I do so, of course, in the name of my Lord Jesus Christ, desiring that He be exalted in all that we do. Oh, it is ever my aim, it is ever my desire that He would be exalted in every way, and thus God is glorified when He, the Holy Spirit, overtakes, underrules, undergirds, illuminates, and thus opens our hearts. Thus the Word of God is made effectual to us, and it does so to the honor and glory of Him who alone is worthy of all honor and glory and praise. And so we would do honor unto our God in the Trinity of His persons, seeking ever to declare the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit, that we might thus be blessed in His presence. And so it's my desire for you that it might be your experience as well, as we endeavor just now to preach His word, to set forth the truths that are to be evidently manifest among us. It's good that we have these opportunities. This liberty is not afforded to people around the world. And I urge you, in the spirit of this thought of being a prayer meeting message, that you pray for those persecuted peoples. And there are those, there's more of them, I believe, than there are of us. And so we hear of the atrocities, we know of the offenses, we know the hatred for the things of God, and we pray for them. But we also pray for our land, because it is becoming more and more openly manifest that there is a hatred for God in the land. Many people talk about patriotism, and obviously that's on the wane, but the fact is that there is much more to be concerned that God is not, as the psalmist said, in all their thoughts. And also, the psalmist lamented very grievously that, help, Lord, for the godly man ceaseth. In other words, that they're less and less. And this I've addressed in this format before with the alarm of a lack of young preachers. There are some, and I pray for them. But I look back to the day, and perhaps even in my youth or in my younger days in the ministry, in which there were a lot of us around, and slowly but surely I've seen them go by the wayside, many younger than me. And there we express that concern before God. After all, our business in being in this world, our conversation is in heaven. That's where our citizenship is. Our business in being in this world is to declare the kingdom of God, to set forth the good news of His mercy, of His kindness toward others, and that we might clearly understand and rejoice in the knowledge that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. These thoughts have given way to the idea of the lordship of men, not the lordship of Christ. And this I would point you to in every way that I possibly can. We're going to look into the second chapter of the book of Ephesians today. And it's my reason for doing so will become apparent in just a moment, but as before we do, let's look to the Lord in a word of prayer. I want you to know that I do pray for you. I'm going to pray for you just now, and we will continue to do so as God will give us indeed ability to do so. So let's look to our Heavenly Father. Father, we thank You for this day. Thank You for the privilege that I have of calling upon Your name and of interceding for these, my people, that I love. And Lord, I think in particular of the two churches that Thou hast given me to minister to, and I too truly ask Your blessings upon them, every one. But I pray for the gospel, wherever it might be, for people of faith, wherever they might be. I pray, O Lord, that you would manifest your mercies, and especially where many are doing it at the cost of their own blood, of their lives. But help, O Lord, and we know that the gospel will prevail, because where there is life in Christ, there is always that expectation of coming into thy presence. And so men are able to face this world without fear. Enable us, O Lord, that we do so. We pray for our nation, for our community, but especially we pray for the propagation of the gospel to thy glory. In Jesus' name, and amen. In Ephesians chapter 2, we have something that I'm just going to refer to as the foundation of our faith. And this Ephesians chapter 2, the passage I'm going to read to you, is quite familiar. And it's one that I have quoted often. And you may at first glance just simply say, okay, I know all about that one. And I'm sure that you know, you may know more about it than you do about many other passages in the Word of God. But sometimes we just simply need to be careful. And it may be just like that prized possession that we've got hidden away someplace in a box, but periodically we just need to take it out and look at it. And the gospel is a multifaceted jewel. Whichever way you turn it, it reflects the glory of God. And so it is with the passages of Scripture that might be most familiar to us. They will still be those things that as we pursue them, we'll see the glory of God manifested. So let me read to you the first 10 verses of Ephesians chapter 2. And you hath he quickened who were dead in trespasses and sins, wherein in time past you walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that now worketh in the children of disobedience, among whom also we had our conversation, or citizenship, in times past in the lusts of our flesh, fulfilling the desires of the flesh and of the mind, and were by nature the children of wrath, even as others. But God, love those buts in the Scripture, but God, who is rich in mercy, for his great love wherewith he loved us, even when we were dead in sins, hath quickened us together with Christ. By grace ye are saved. And he hath raised us up together, and made us sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus, that in the ages to come he might show the exceeding riches of his grace in his kindness toward us through Christ Jesus. For by grace are ye saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, it is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast, for we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus, unto good works, which God hath before ordained that we should walk in them. And may God richly bless the reading of his word, and may we remain focused thereon, even as we would look at these things and seek to grow in grace and knowledge and in honoring him. As I said, this foundation of our faith, quite often we look to those passages of Scripture in which they are presented to us in a compendious way. And what I mean by that, it's just sort of a compact or a concise statement that lays the groundwork for some particular truth or some particular teaching that we might otherwise elaborate on at great length. And as to this passage of Scripture, I can go to at least three portions of it and know that I have preached several times on just those. And here I want to try to deal with this in a rather brief manner, owing to their time limits and so on. So, but in any event, there are some basic foundational things that you need to know, that all men need to know, and that we need to declare. This is perhaps can be starting point and thus men be made to understand. Sometimes we have to gauge where we start based on what the knowledge is of the ones or the one to whom we speak. And so if we come to a person that has never even so much as heard of God, then we got to start with him as creator. When we know that there is those who have some knowledge or some awareness that the Bible is the Word of God, then there's many that will go that far but fall far short of the mark as far as knowing God in Jesus Christ is concerned. And so we have here, though, a place to begin. And Paul does just exactly that. Because even as he would address himself, and in the first chapter, Paul reached back into the depths of eternity and there described the eternal love of God for his people and the manner in which the revelation came to us. And we read in the 13th verse that in whom you also trusted after that you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, in which after you believed that you were sealed with the Holy Spirit of promise. And so this, we're back to there. But now he would literally just take me back. And I love to be taken back. Let me just go back from the beginning. And it's sometimes good that we're able to do that. Because, first of all, we're going to look, and we often use the term, the depravity of man. It's a misunderstood term. Often it is a perverted term in terms of those who would oppose its teaching, and it's often just simply passed over in a light fashion, accepted in a way, without any thought of personal experience regarding it. And that's always a problem. And when I'm talking about depravity, I'm not talking about man being as bad as he could be, but depravity declares what the scripture does, that man is ruined. As he comes into this world, and the descriptions are many and varied throughout the Word of God, that he is completely incapable of doing anything but walking a sinful path. And this he does. And until there is divine intervention, till the mercy of God is applied, he may reform, he may do various things that might make him outwardly look better, but the thought is that he is ruined at the depth of his being. He inherited Adam's sinful nature. And man does what he does by the nature that is within him. And so the nature, David said, I came forth from my mother's womb speaking lies. And the prophet declared that the heart of man is desperately wicked. Who can know it? But that being said, let's look at our experience. And this is what Paul calls our attention to. And so I have to do that. You hath he quickened, made alive. There's a time in which I was not alive to these truths. There was a time when I was walking my own way, doing what I wanted to do, and often without a thought of God. And when I did have thoughts of God, they were short-lived, quickly snatched away, and had little if any impact upon me. But notice what he said. He quickened us who were dead in trespasses and sins. If you do not know the Lord today, then understand this. This is the state that you're still in. If you know the Lord, understand that this is the state that you were in, that you were dead in trespasses and sins, literally without ability to respond unto God, cut off from eternal life and manifesting it by trespasses and sins as a way of life. And so this I've often thought about as the walking dead, because even though we can preach to people, well, you're dead. And they said, well, wait a minute, they pinch themselves. No, I'm not. I'm alive. Hey, I can see, I can hear, I can do all of these things. So I'm not dead. But as far as God is concerned, you are, because you have no response to him. There is no sensitivity. A dead man, you prick him with a pin, he's not going to react. He doesn't feel a thing. Yet, at the same time, we take dead sinners, and they may hear the word of God, and it has none effect on them. He that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches. And so it is that as we see these things, he's actually walking in a dead state. Listen to the further description. Wherein in time past, this is what you were to begin with, you walked according to the course of this world. You followed the natural order of things. According, though, now let's go even deeper, because the course of this world is the same course that is dictated by Satan himself. According to the course of the world, according to the prince of the power of the air. And this is the spirit that now worketh in the children of disobedience. Now we can easily look and say, yeah, I see all the devilish things that are taking place. Let me tell you something. Whatsoever is not of faith is sin. Whatsoever things are not of the spirit, they are unacceptable to God. And yet, as we look at this and understand that men often, in various and sundry ways, go about the business of this present world, that they're being guided by whatever their flesh dictates. It's by the desires of the flesh and of the mind, and we're by nature the children of wrath, even as others. I marvel. Not only do I see it in this world, but perhaps entertainment and those selling of those things that are built for the amusement or for the pleasure, for whatever it is of man, and he's going to do those things. And quite often, he's going to pursue those things rather than the things of God. Sadly, I see it even among professed believers that they will give more preeminence. Don't misunderstand me. The fact is that there is nothing wrong with enjoying oneself as long as he is walking by faith and recognizing that he is dealing in this creation that God gave us to enjoy. But understand that this, the manner of life that is witnessed here, it's the same one that I had before I was saved. It's the same one that if God takes his hand off of me, I'd be right back there. It's the same one that my old fallen nature tries to pursue even now. And just simply, it is because of that spiritual warfare within that we shall not, sin shall not, Paul said, have dominion over us. But we had our citizenship in times past, the lust of our flesh, fulfilling the desires of the flesh and the mind, and were by nature the children of wrath, even as others. And so, first of all, we see that groundwork. If man does not see that he's lost, he never seeks to be saved. If he doesn't realize, don't come to that realization that he is helpless. And this is why Christ would say, they that be whole need not a physician, but they that are sick, those that realize that circumstance. And so it is, we read then the necessity that had to take place. It's not of man to do it. He's going to say this later on. He'll be quite specific about it. But God, he says here, and here again, but God. Typically, we read in the scriptures where we find a but, that on the left side of it is a bad thing. And on the left side of this is the depravity that we existed in, the depravity that is characteristic of our old nature, and that from which we must be delivered. But God, and on the right side is the remedy, who is rich in his mercy for his great love wherewith he loved us, even when we were dead in sins, hath quickened us together with Christ. By grace are you saved. Look at what has happened. The mercy of God is such that he so acts and that he must. And when I read, but God who is rich in his mercy, that it's he that hath quickened, or it's he that is made alive, it's he that is born again. If this says that God did it, that says that there was no other way to do it. As long as man thinks he can do something, God may just let him try. He may let him flail around until he winds up destroyed. And the fact that we see these truths by God's mercy and by God's grace, that we're even able to comprehend these things and to realize, and oh, what a mercy it is indeed. Understand this, mercy is God not giving us what we deserve. If he went based on what we were in that description in the first three verses, then what alternative does he have but to cast us forever out of his sight? But he's rich in mercy for his great love wherewith he loved us. And I want you to understand something. It is because of his mercy. It was because there was no other way. And if God did it, it's because it had to be done. And that it was because of his determination. I will have mercy, he said, on whom I will have mercy. And we must understand that. This is not a matter of divine obligation. It is a matter of divine volition. He'll do as he wills. And so we understand that he was moved by his love. And even, Paul is reinforcing this thought, even when we were in that state of rebellion, even when we were dead in sins, he hath quickened us together with Christ. He didn't just keep us from that way of life. He brought us unto new life in Christ. He quickened us together with Christ. Having raised him from the dead, now he raises us from a dead state through regeneration and brings us unto this living, working knowledge of himself. And oh my, how dare we ever presume upon this and ever think that there is any merit to be found with us. And so, even when we're in that way, made us alive, made us responsive to him. I think this is the thought that we need to understand. Somebody says, oh, you just got to believe. That's all there is to it. And I will agree with you that you must repent and believe the gospel. But I will tell you this also, until there is life given from above, there will be no responsiveness to the divine mandate to repent and believe the gospel. It's God's mercy. And that's why I constantly bid men, fall on the mercy of God. Believe him. Trust him. You say, but you've told me I can't. But I'm telling you that you must. And thus, as you are brought to the place of seeking it. And there is purpose in this. And I'm trying to cover this in an allotted amount of time, and I don't want to do any damage to it. And so consequently, as I look at these things, I am aware that there is so much that is to be dealt with here. But I want you to see that Paul has coupled this with the eternal purpose of God. Because now we read, he's by grace are you saved. And then in verse 6, he said, he's raised us up together and made us sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. Now, the place of our residency has changed. The manner of our citizenship has changed. The nature of our existence now is incorporated in life with the Lord Jesus Christ. And positionally, we are seated with Christ. It's a done deal, folks. When we come to know the Lord Jesus Christ, it is because of all that he has accomplished, and the purpose of God cannot be thwarted. To any that might be listening that believes that you could possibly be saved and then lose it, listen to what the purpose of God was in raising you up together to begin with. Because here is what he said, that in the ages to come he might show the exceeding riches of his grace in his kindness toward us through Christ Jesus. And thus we understand purpose. Call it a selfish purpose of God. His aim was not only that because he loved us, he showed us mercy, and then because he loved us, he raised us up together with his only begotten Son, that Christ lives in us and we in him, and that we have that living, moving identity with him. But it's his purpose that from now on he will be about the business of showing us the exceeding riches of his grace in his kindness toward us in Christ Jesus. I have heard people say, oh, it is so wonderful to be saved. And I join that chorus. I cannot think of life apart from the Lord Jesus Christ. I cannot envision not knowing him and not being guided by his mercy and by his grace, led by his Spirit. I cannot understand any that would think in those terms. And that being said, to realize that I haven't seen the half of it. It will continue through all eternity. Joy will continually increase. Revelation will always be going on throughout eternity. Say, what do you mean, revelation? I mean that you will know more and more of God with greater and greater delight in the experience of ever-increasing joy and ever-delighting in the worship of the one true God and Jesus Christ whom he has sent. Oh my, this that the Spirit of God shows us now and will show us then. So he makes that declaration that we have heard so often. Here is what were the reasoning. Here is foundational truth. For by grace are you saved through faith. And that not of yourselves. It is the gift of God. It didn't come from you. It is by grace, through faith, and all of this is the gift of God. Grace, it would be redundant to say that grace is the gift because that's what grace is. It's God giving us what we do not deserve. Faith is that gift that man wants to take credit. All you have to do is believe. Well, I'm glad I believed. I'm glad I made myself. No, you didn't. Faith is a gift. It's a spiritual gift. It's manifested to us through the work of the Holy Spirit. And thus you did. Yes, you were exercised in it. It was you that really believed. It was you that really trusted. It was you that really delighted. All of these things are true. But he quite clearly, though, declares it, that it is not of yourselves. It's not you. It is the gift of God. It is his doing. Now, that's not enough. Because he goes on to declare in no uncertain terms in the ninth verse, specifically, not of works. Man's going to immediately say, oh, I did this and I did this. And, you know, and there's people that are still doing it. Read the accounts of the Pharisees in the New Testament scriptures and see how much they were about the business of bragging on themselves, of taking credit for things that only God could do. Could only be merited. They were only perfectly realized in the person of Jesus Christ our Lord. And so it is thus required. Specifically, it's not of works. Now you say, but wait a minute. God commands us to do good works. Yes, he does. And Paul this does not leave that stone unturned. Because in the next verse, verse 10, for we are his workmanship, created. And I want you to hear that, created. It's not we that made ourselves, he made us. We're created in our original form. But then, indeed, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. He is a new creation, born again of the Spirit of God, born of incorruptible seed. We are created in Christ Jesus unto good works. In other words, where our old nature was to follow the course of the world, to follow the course of the prince of the power of the air, that's our old nature. Our new nature is to do good works because that's what God has ordained for us. That not of yourselves, it's the gift of God, not of works. His workmanship in Christ Jesus unto good works, which God hath before ordained that we should walk in them. Now, I realize I've covered a lot of territory that's been covered many times before. But, beloved, it is good that we think on these things. We look to that which is pleasant. We look to that which gives us assurance. We look to that to measure ourselves. How are we walking now? To what are we responding? To whom is our allegiance pledged? And in whom do we find our citizenship? And to whom do we worship? To whom do we set forth the sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving in all of our ways? May the Lord bless you just now, is my prayer.